Hey, I want to say impressed that you're here in church today, last Sunday of the year. Some churches don't even have church on the last Sunday of the year, and you are here powering through, breaking through the finish line. We're going to finish strong in 2015. You ready for that? Yeah. And looking forward to an incredible 2016. I want to take a couple of minutes and before I start my message and just say thank you to everyone who helped serve and make Christmas Eve an incredible success. We had three meetings, 2 o'clock, 4 o'clock, 6 o'clock. This room was packed to capacity in every one of those meetings. And those of you that that bought the idea that, Christmas would be a great opportunity to serve people and serve the church and got involved in making it all happen, just want to say thank you. Can we give a great big hand to all of our volunteers to say thank you? And you know, one of the things that we're trying to do with Christmas Eve, of course, is to worship Jesus and the point towards him, but we are also trying to help people connect with Jesus. And just happy to report to you that in those three services on Christmas Eve, 44 people gave their life to Christ on Christmas Eve, and I think that is incredible. So just thank you to everybody who participated in that. And then let me give you a little bit of backstory or the why behind why we are changing our service times. Just to make you upset. No, not really. you know, I've been, our church is a Spirit-filled church. And we believe in the presence and the reality and the gifts and the power of the Holy Spirit to change our lives. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Yeah. And I just felt kind of like for the past season that we had gotten ourselves in such a tight situation in trying to do church the best that we possibly could. That I just felt like we needed to create some more breathing room in our church services and even in our time between services. So we literally spent probably 2 or 3 months just thinking, praying, looking around at what other churches were doing and trying to figure out the best way that we could kind of just open up some a little more space for us just to breathe and to let the Holy Spirit touch our lives and to move in our midst. And so that's how we ended up changing our service times to 9:30 and 11:15, whereas now we're 10 and 11:30. So that's kind of the reasoning behind it all, just to give us a little more room to breathe. Probably one thing that would help that breathing room happen too is if the pastor would start preaching shorter messages, and that is going to be a good hearty effort. No promise, just a good hearty effort for 2016. But one of the things that we're also doing is we are in this past season, we've had middle school service in the first service, but not in the second, and we're expanding that to where we have middle school service in both services. And we're looking forward to the fruit of that. And then we are also going to experiment with a concept called pattern interrupt. And that idea is going to be, there will be some services that will be entirely different from other services. So I know some of you guys have this thing timed to the minute to show up like after worship or when worship is almost over, and then you know what time to leave and slip out. And so we're going to mess with you. And so there may be a service where we would sing one song and I'm going to start teaching. And there's going to be a service where we're going to sing 6 songs. Who knows? And we're just going to mess around a little bit. And you know, one of the guiding principles for us is everything is an experiment. And we are willing just to say, let's give it a go. Let's see what God does with it. If it works, it was God. If it was stupid, it was us. And we'll just totally take the blame and give him the credit for whatever works. And so I am really, like really looking forward to seeing what God wants to do in the middle of us and for us, in us, through us in 2016. Anybody in for that? So it's going to be fun. So this is the last 10 o'clock service for a while. So if you are committed to first service, then it's going to be starting at 9:30 next week. And then the second service will be 11:15. So this is going to be a whole lot of fun. Well, we're in a series of messages that has grown a little bit for me, but there's a big idea. It's called Supporting Cast, and I'd be curious. This is the fourth message in Supporting Cast, and you know, one of the things that we're trying to get our head wrapped around with our church is the attendance and attendance patterns for our church, because certainly things have shifted there. I would just by a show of hands, I would like to know how many people have actually been here for all four messages of Supporting Cast. Let me see. Just raise your hand real high. Fantastic. Good for you. All right. Are those little stars ready for their foreheads to as they leave today? That is very cool. So here's the big idea behind the concept of Supporting Cast. The idea is this. The Christmas story that we read in the Bible is about Jesus. The mic could just say amen, that'd be okay. You can lean in, it's the last Sunday of the year, come on. Lean in and enjoy it for a minute. The Christmas story is about Jesus. But in that story, there were a whole lot of different people who held down supporting cast roles in the story. And my realization is that not only is the Christmas story about Jesus, but every story is ultimately about Jesus. So the story of my marriage, the story of this church, the story of your career, the story of your finances, the story of your friendships, the story of your relationships, the story of any project that you have in your heart, eventually that story is going to be best served when we realize that our best life is when we quit trying to be the star of the show and we actually recognize that Jesus is the star of the show, and we choose to recognize that our role is simply a supporting cast role. I could say there would be nothing that would help your marriage more than to recognize this truth. There would be nothing that would help your work career go better than to recognize this truth. You in a supporting cast role is far greater a story than you as the star of the story. One of my best illustrations that has helped me understand the ability to kind of recenter on how we should think about what's the starting point, what's the first button on the shirt, is for years, people could not figure out an accurate calendar. And the reason they couldn't figure out an accurate calendar was because for the longest time, astronomers, astrologists, those who study the stars and the heavens, they all thought that the Earth was the center of our solar system. And it wasn't until Galileo threw out the idea that the Earth, in fact, was not the center of the solar system, but in fact, the sun is the center of our solar system. And when we begin to realize what the true center is, what the true starting point is, that's when people were able to put together an accurate calendar that would actually work. And so I think for a lot of us, we've got to have that realization at some point in our life where we realize that I'm not the center of the solar system, Jesus is. And if I could recognize him as the center of the solar system, I am going to live a whole lot better life than me trying to be the center of the solar system of life. Anybody hear what I'm talking about? Amen. So I've been reading this story out of the New Testament. I want to read it one more time to you. Luke chapter 2, verse 25 says, "There was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. This man was righteous and devout, looking for the consolation of Israel. The Holy Spirit was upon him. It had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he'd seen the Lord's Christ. So he came in the Spirit into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to carry out for him the custom of the law, he took Jesus into his arms and he blessed God. And he said, 'Now, Lord, you are releasing your bondservant to depart in peace according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the presence of all peoples, a light of revelation to the Gentiles and the glory of your people Israel.' And his father and his mother were amazed at the things which were being said about him. Simeon blessed them and said to Mary, Jesus' mother, 'Behold, this child is appointed for the fall and the rise of many in Israel, for a sign to be opposed, a sword that will pierce even your own soul, to the end that thoughts from many hearts may be revealed.'" Verse 36 says, "There was a prophetess, Anna, the daughter of Phanuel of the tribe of Asher. She was advanced in years, having lived with her husband 7 years after her marriage. Then as a widow to the age of 84, she never left the temple, serving night and day with fastings and prayers. And at that very moment, she came up and began giving thanks to God and continued to speak of him to all those who were looking for the redemption of Jerusalem." Now, in this lady Anna, the prophetess, life, I see some characteristics that helped her fulfill her supporting cast role that I believe if we understood those characteristics, we would also fulfill our supporting cast role the best. And so there's 6 things, and I've been talking about them for a couple of weeks. Number 1 is this: she let her difficulties push her closer to God. Luke 2 verse 36 says, "She was advanced in years, having lived with a husband 7 years after her marriage, and then as a widow." So her husband dies after they had been married for 7 years, and now she's all the way to the age of 84. I see in this something that is so powerful and so profound, and the idea is that the loss of her husband seemed to catapult her closer to God rather than come between her and God. And I have just watched this over the years where people will experience a difficulty or some kind of just the stuff that happens on planet Earth, just the stuff that happens to all of us. And that can either come as a wedge between them and their walk with God, or it actually is a wedge that drives them closer to God because they learn to lean in to God. They learn to learn something from God. They lean into the Word of God. They lean into the presence of God. They lean into church. They don't quit serving God, but they actually let their difficulties push them closer to God rather than push them away from God. Anytime somebody says, "You know, I was doing well, but then this thing happened and I just got so disappointed and it just kind of made me quit church or made me quit walking with God," I'm thinking, time out. That was your moment to draw near. That was your moment to get peace and strength and comfort from God. The second thing I see about her was that she was devoted to the house of God. This is what kept her in the story. The Bible says she never left the temple. Now, I don't know if that's literally that she never left the temple. I don't think that would be true. But I would say that in her heart, she never separated from the house of God. Something in her heart was tied to the house of God. She had a recognition that the church, as imperfect as it is God's house, God's creation. Church is God's idea. It's not a creation of man. It's not an institution of man. It's not an organization of man. Church is God's idea. And church is God's plan to get into the planet. The house of God is the gate of heaven. It's plan A. There's no plan B. God wants to plant life-giving churches in every city, every community, every region of planet Earth. I'm saying to you that if you could buy this idea, that if you will consistently invest your life into the local church that God wants you to be part of, it's one of the best ways to stay in the story that God is writing on planet Earth. Sometimes people have this little house church idea. You know, they just want to kind of hang out in a house church, and that usually becomes an us four and no more group. Don't shout me down because I'm preaching real good on the last Sunday of the year. And I'm saying just meeting in a kumbaya, just look after each other kind of group, that is not what Jesus intended for his church on the earth. He wants to reach the planet, and he wants to reach the planet through his church. The third thing I see about her is that she had a servant's heart. The Bible says she never left the temple serving. Everybody say serving. Serving night and day with fastings and prayers. Anna's relationship with God resulted in service to God. And I'm convinced that one of the most legit manifestations of a person having a relationship with God is them starting to ask this question, Lord, what do you want me to do? And that is within the heart of every person who's had a real encounter with Jesus. If you look at everybody in the Bible that had an encounter with God, that had an encounter with God in the Old Testament or the New Testament, without fail, their response was always, Lord, I don't even deserve this. What do you want me to do? And I think it's one of the hallmarks of any person who has a legit relationship with the Lord is they were committed not to just taking it in, but they were committed to serving the purpose of God. The fourth thing that I see in Anna's life is that she had a strong prayer life. The Bible says that she was serving night and day with fastings and prayer. Every great move of God that's ever happened historically has always been prefaced by and led by a tribe of people who were committed to intercessory prayer. At this side of the room, see if I can get a better reaction. Anytime you ever see God actually moving in the earth, any revival, any outpouring of the Holy Spirit, any move of God, it's always had a strong intercessory prayer component. Now, you do not have to spend much time watching any of the news to recognize that our nation is in serious need of a move of God. Our world is in a serious need. And what our nation does not need is more church services. What our nation does need is people who say, I see what God wants to do on the earth, and I am committing myself to be a part of serving the purpose of God with fastings and prayer. Few things could be more valuable than a devotion to a life of prayer to keep you in the story that Jesus is writing on the earth. And I'm asking you as our church family to buy the power of this and the strength of this and the idea of this. In January, we always have a strong emphasis on starting the year well in prayer. And I just want to invite you to a couple of things. Four ways that you could get involved at the beginning of January. Number one is that you could start to become part of pre-service prayer. Now that service times are starting at 9:30, we move that back 8:45 to 9 o'clock. Can I encourage you to make that a part of your schedule and be here for at least one Sunday of the month? You could go every Sunday of the month. It wouldn't hurt a thing at all. And just be a part of pre-service prayer, creating atmosphere, seeking after God, joining together with us just to fill this place with a spirit of faith and the presence of God. And then we are for the season in front of us, we're doing first Saturday prayer meetings. That's going to be January 2nd is coming up, first Saturday prayer. And that is from 9 o'clock to 10 o'clock, every first Saturday of the month. You can come with bedhead, it doesn't even matter. You can come in your gym, well, you just put something on that looks okay. And you can just come and pray with us for an hour, and let's seek after God together. First Saturday prayer, January 2nd. Come on, you're ready to dive into a new year anyway, aren't you? Let's do it. And then the third thing that you could do is you could be with us on a Wednesday night for mega worship. And you might say, this is a lot of prayer. Hey, listen, you can't pray too much. And I'm saying to you, this is a way to start off the new year right. Mega worship on Wednesday nights, coming in here 7 o'clock till 8:30, and we are going to have an incredible time worshiping God and praying together and believing. And then January 11th through the 31st, we are doing 21 days of fasting and prayer. You do not have to fast for 21 days, especially if you've never done anything like that before. If you have and you're kind of a warrior and you're into it, you can do it. More power to you. But I'm just encouraging all of us to choose some of that time or all of that time just to say, I am going to delete some activity out of my life that is swallowing my attention, swallowing my time. I'm going to say no to some things that have to do with food just to let my body quiet down and start to listen to God. All throughout the Bible, you find people seeking God with fasting and prayer. All throughout history, you see people seeking God with fasting and prayer. I just say to you, if you will start your year first things first, if you will start that first month of the year like this, you could have the best year of your life. All right, number five is this. Anna had a thankful heart. She had a gratitude in her heart. So verse 38 says, at that very moment, she came up and began giving thanks. Everybody say thanks. She began giving thanks to God. You are in your absolute healthiest state of mind when you are grateful. You are in your absolute healthiest spiritual spot when you are full of gratitude. When your spirit is locked in on what you are grateful for, that is the healthiest possible place for you to look at all of life. That is the healthiest place. An attitude of gratitude, a heart that's full of thanksgiving. And 1 Thessalonians 5 says this, rejoice always, pray without ceasing, in everything give thanks. This is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Want to know what the will of God is? Rejoice, pray, and give thanks. If you're wanting to know the will of God, you can't figure out what to do, I'll tell you, this will put you in the right spot to figure out what to do. Rejoice, pray, and give thanks. A lack of gratitude is like a disease. It's like a disease to your emotions. A lack of gratitude, not focused on the good things that God has done in your life, is a disease to your mindset. It's a disease to your spiritual health. Everybody has within them, and it's part of our sin nature, an eye that finds the negative, that finds the wrong. And all of us can have a tendency to focus in on the thing that is wrong, that needs to be fixed, that could be better. And it has to be an on-purpose move to go, I am going to fix my thoughts and fix my sight on the good that is going on in my life rather than the bad that's going on in my life. An attitude of thanksgiving is always the proper vantage point to view your life. Come on, if you want to look at your work in the right perspective, you're going to have to stop and go, what am I grateful for? Not what's wrong with it. If you want to look at your spouse from the right perspective, you got to go, what do I like about them? Because if you want the right vantage point to look at your church, you got to stop and go, what is good about the place? What is God actually doing? Not what do I want him to be doing. What is he doing? Because a lot of people are living in that zone of, this is what I want God to be doing, but he's not doing that, he's doing this. But they're not even looking at this, they're looking at that, and they're always out of sync with their season. I'm saying the wrong place to stand and look at life is standing in a place of self-pity. Ain't nobody knows what I'm going through. Nobody has any idea how hard this is. The wrong vantage point is standing in a place of doubt. The wrong vantage point is standing in the place where you are unappreciative. The wrong vantage point is standing in a place where you are cynical. Cynical is easy. Some people think they have the gift of cynical. Please, do not give any of us that gift. Gratitude is simply locating the positives in your life. Every one of us has a list of negatives and a list of positives. We all could either focus on what's wrong, what needs to be fixed, what we'd like to see better, or we could get focused on what's right. And I'm saying that focus on the positives in your life is the healthiest focus you can have. I'm not saying you completely ignore what needs to be fixed. I'm just saying to have an attitude that is thankful is your healthiest place. It's your godliest place. It's your strongest place. It's your best place to live. If you're going to stay in the story that God is writing, You're going to have to stay focused, and you're going to have to keep peeling back the part of you that wants to look at what's wrong and keep making yourself look at what's right. We have a incessant tinkering attitude in leading our church because we really are trying to be the best that we can possibly be for the glory of God. So the only downside of incessant tinkering with the church is sometimes you could just get focused on, we got to fix this, we got to fix that, we got to fix this, we got to fix that, we got to fix you, well, got to fix me. And I think it would serve every person in this place well to, today is the 27th, you got a couple of days to look back on your calendar and go, oh my gosh, these are the great things that happened this year. I am still alive. Woohoo! You might say, I look back on this year and I gained 25 pounds. Well, thank God you're healthy enough to gain some weight. We sat down the other day and just thought, let's locate the positives for our church. Let's locate some of the victories for 2015. And I just want to share them with you because this is our victories together. Our church together had really one of the best years that we've ever had in the history of our church. And the first thing is we celebrated 26 years as a church. Come on. I could take you back to churches that were the talk of the town 10 years ago that don't even exist today. And I say thank God for the grace of God that our church has continued to move forward and reach people and help people and glorify God and have a little bit of fun along the way. Amen. Our fall kickoff Sunday, which is what we used to call Friends and Family Day, turned out it was literally our largest ever in 26 years as a church. We had 1,070 people here, and 40 people gave their life to Christ on Fall Kickoff Sunday. Come on. That happened this past year. That was in the fall. In Easter, in the spring, our Easter services were literally the four Easter services, Good Friday, three Easter services, the largest ever in the history of our church. 2,075 people attended Easter services. 75 people gave their life to Christ on Easter weekend. Come on, anybody grateful with me? I just told you Christmas Eve, we just had 44 people give their life to Christ just Thursday night. Awesome. This past summer, we had our very first high school internship, brand new thing. I love new things. This past year, we had our first full year of Celebrate Recovery. This year, we had 94 people get baptized in water, making a public profession of their faith in Christ, the most ever in any year in 26 years in our church. Amen. 94. We had 66 get baptized on Big Baptism Sunday. This year, 2015, we had the most mission trips that we've ever had, 5 trips. We had 67 people that went on those trips, and they all came back. The most ever. Say the most ever. The most ever. Yeah, our Endeavor spring offering to renovate this place and make it fresh and new. We, in the springtime, we received Endeavor spring offering, and that Sunday, I think it was the last Sunday of May, we received our largest ever one-day cash offering. Not pledges, cash offering. $271,000 was given. That's what we did as a church. And then we just had our Endeavor Christmas offering to help us move forward. And I'm not ready to reveal the number, but all I'm telling you is that that number is now in second place. Come on. Our local outreaches increased in such an incredible way. We strengthened our relationships with the Rescue Mission, with Trinity Place, with Canton Community Kitchen, with Cornerstone Rescue Home, with the Asheville Pregnancy Support Service. In other words, our church making Asheville a better place for the glory of God. Amen. This past year, we had 145 people join our church, new members join our church this year. And then I could keep going on and on, but let me just say this. The last one is this. In 2015, over 1,400 people gave their life to Christ in 2015. Come on. Somebody thank God with me. Come on. Somebody be grateful. Amen. We started out the year with a series of messages called This Is My Year. Anybody remember that? This is my year. And God has certainly graced us with an incredible year. I've started a couple of new practices myself personally. I used to have a prayer list, and as soon as we were done with it, I just kind of crossed the item off of my prayer list, and I thought, I'm just hanging on to my prayer list for a while, and I'm keeping it intact. So I'm looking back, and I'm saying, oh, I prayed over this, and this is what God did, and I prayed over that, and this is what God did. Because sometimes you can pray and pray God does something, but you look back 4 months, 6 months, 9 months, and you go, does God even answer prayer? And once you get that list of thanksgiving going inside of your heart, can I tell you, if you'll stay focused on what God is doing, instead of getting so focused on what you want Him to be doing, you are going to be in an incredible place. Then the last idea that I want to share with you very quickly, and only because I don't want this series to go to another 2 months, is this. Anna continually shared her faith with others. What kept her in the story? What kept her in a supporting cast role? The Bible says in verse 38, at the very moment she came up and began giving thanks to God. I bet she's glad she went to church that day and didn't stay at the house, right? And continued to speak of Him to all those who were looking for the redemption of Israel. I love this concept. She continued to speak of Him to all those who were looking. She didn't push anything on people who weren't looking. She started finding people who were looking and shared with them what God was doing. When I first gave my heart to Christ, we started out kamikaze Christians. And that is, we would all load up in this panel van that we used to smoke pot in, and we fumigated it out, and all loaded in this panel van, and would drive down to the French Quarter in New Orleans, where I grew up, and we'd pour out on the streets and in on Bourbon Street and in the French Quarter and hand out tracts and try to witness to people and try to share our faith. And I have some interesting stories from that whole thing. But I want to tell you a lesson that I learned and that is this. When I first started going to witness on the streets in New Orleans, I was just interested in getting as many tracks out as I possibly could. And I started to realize this isn't doing any good for anybody. And I just slowed it down a little bit. And I just started to look for people that I just felt like I'd get a little ping in my spirit. And I'd just walk over and say, hey, man, how you going? Can we talk for a minute? And I'd hand them a track. And I would find so much more fruitfulness talking about him to people who are looking. Everybody's looking. But some are at an earlier part of their journey than others. Most people, when they meet Christ, they will normally have traditionally maybe 7 encounters with God or with a person that tells them about the Lord. And the truth is, I know this. If I start to share with somebody, and as soon as I meet resistance, I may realize I'm just maybe encounter number 3. I am talking about him to those who are looking. And I'm not going to go past whatever the Holy Spirit has done in their heart. Because how many of you know you're never going to convince somebody with a good argument to accept Christ? Because if it was reasonable, hello, here's the alternative. Heaven forever with Jesus, hell forever without him. Is that a hard decision? If somebody was really being logical and thinking it through. And so the truth is, I may be encounter number 3, I might be encounter number 5, and I realize that even in church, when we're giving people an opportunity to respond to the Lord, I don't know how far we are on the journey, but I'm just saying, here, I'm going to be a part of talking about those who are looking, talking about him to those who are looking. Here's what I want to say. If you want to be in the story that God is writing, then sharing your faith is a big part of that story. Your faith is private to you, but it's to be shared with others. Here's how the kingdom of God grows. The kingdom of God advances, the story grows as people share with other people what God has done in their life. And you may not have the answers to every question that somebody may throw towards you. But I will tell you this, nobody can deny your story. They might have a question that you don't have an answer, but nobody, when you say, this is what God did for me, they could say, no, he didn't. And I could say, yeah, he did. Anna found something great and wanted to share it. She's always talking about the great things God was doing in her life. Philemon 1, verse 6 says, I pray that you'd be active in sharing your faith so that you'd have a full understanding of every good thing that you have in Christ. Come on. Your faith grows as you share it. How to stay in the story, real quick, all right? 6 things, how to stay in the story. How to fulfill a supporting cast role. Number 1, let your difficulties push you closer to God. Number 2, be devoted to the house of God. Number 3, have a servant's heart. Number 4, have a strong prayer life. Number 5, have a thankful heart. Number 6, continually share your faith with others. Come on, anybody want to be supporting cast to the great story that Jesus is writing? I want you to bow your heads for a moment and I want you to close your eyes. God has a very specific supporting cast role for you to play. But we all have to know, I've got to open my heart to him to fulfill that role. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Come on, maybe you're here today. It's the last Sunday of this year. We're getting ready to go into a brand new year. The possibilities are so great when our life is in the hands of God. And I just want to pray with you today. Maybe you've never really given your heart to Christ. I would love to pray with you. Maybe you're here today and you used to be close to God, but you know you're not where you used to be. You're not where you want to be. You're not where you know you should be. Today would be a great day to open your heart to Him. Maybe you just feel unsure about where you stand. Nobody's looking around. I just want to pray with you. If you say, Pastor, please, I want you to include me in this prayer. I want to give my life to Christ. I want to come back to Him. I want to be sure I'm right with Him. One of those might describe your place right now. If that's you, I want you to lift your hand right now and say, would you pray for me? Coming all over this room, just lift your hand real high and say, that's me. I want to give my life to Christ. Thank you so much. I want to open my life to Him and come back to Him. I want to be sure I'm right with Him. Is there anybody else that just would say, yeah, thank you, thank you. Thank you over here. Come on all over the room. Thanks. Thank you. Come on, anybody else? Thank you so much. Amen. Let's pray a prayer together. Everybody, let's pray this out loud. This is for those who lifted their hand, but I'd like for us all to say these words together. Everybody say, Lord Jesus, I open my life to your love, to your lordship. I need you. I want you in my world. I know I've sinned and I'm sorry. I come to the cross where you paid the price for my forgiveness. Today is a fresh start. It's a new beginning as I receive Jesus as my Lord. Help me become the person you created me to be. Amen. Come on, let's thank the Lord. Amen.